We often enjoy the conveniences of today's modern economy with little thought to the manufacturing processes involved and the materials consumed in their production. As industrialization spreads across the globe, efficient and environmentally responsible recycling has been the key to conserving our natural resources and energy. One of the critical engines of effective recycling on a massive scale is today's modern shredder, a technological wonder that can process up to 300 to 400 tons of scrap metal an hour, separating component materials that are used as melt feedstock for new steel and metals that are then used by manufacturers in the production of new products. About 130 million net tons of scrap materials were recycled in 2013. Recycling products at the end of their useful life and processing them to extract reusable materials reduces consumption of virgin materials, saves energy, and reduces greenhouse gas emissions. Worldwide, it is estimated that recycling reduces CO2 emissions by 500 million tons per year. Today's efficient recyclers have changed the face of the industrial economy. The shredder is an innovation not unlike the printing press, the internal combustion engine, or the personal computer that has revolutionized the recycling industry, and along with it, the steel manufacturing and foundry industries. Each industry has found ways to conserve natural resources, reduce energy consumption, and prevent valuable materials from entering the waste stream.
Hi, Ms. Siebert. Thanks for taking the time to show me your operation.
Well, please, Seth, you can call me Sarah. Here's our facility safety card. Everyone who comes across the gate has to take a minute to understand our safe operation rules of conduct.
Okay. Sounds pretty serious.
It's very serious.
Thank you.
Here, come on inside.
Okay.
Coffee?
Oh, sure.
So, you're thinking about a career in the recycling industry? Well, what would you like to learn? I'll try to focus our tour to answer as many of your questions as possible.
Okay. Well, Sarah, I'm particularly interested in seeing your shredder in operation. We've learned a lot about the benefits of recycling in my environmental science class.
Oh, well, let's head back to my office.
Okay. I know that without the commercial recycling industry, all of those tons of cast-off materials would find their way into the waste stream, clogging our landfills, polluting the watersheds, and destroying the ozone layer. What I didn't realize was just how mechanized and well-organized a recycling facility can be. It's great to be able to see just how it works in real life.
Well, Seth, you're right. When things reach the end of their useful life, they're broken or worn out, we have the choice to throw them away, they become waste, or we can bring them to the scrapyard and recycle them in order to extract as much component material as possible. We like to say scrap is not waste, recycling is not disposal, because we process the material, extract the value that's still there, and create a feedstock for the manufacturing companies to produce new products. Our goal is to reclaim as much reusable material as possible, so almost nothing goes to waste.
Scrap is not waste. Recycling is not disposal. Okay, I like that. So, it's not just used soda cans and old pots and pans, the stuff we put in the blue bins every Thursday. And you handle almost everything, even big complicated things like cars and washing machines?
Oh, especially things like that. The blue bin is an important but small part of the total recycled materials. Around the yard, you'll see all kinds of things. I-beams from building demolition sites, aluminum siding. Most of the material we handle is industrial scrap. Skeletons from metal stamping, castings that didn't meet specification, and so forth. That scrap is generally made of one kind of metal, and it's easily sheared or shredded into small enough pieces to be transported to the steel mill or the foundry where it's melted down and recast. A car, as you know, is a pretty complex item. It's mostly made of steel, about a dozen different kinds, but it also has non-ferrous materials, such as copper and aluminum. Of course, there are other non-metallic parts like plastics, rubber, and glass.
But the auto dismantler will have already stripped a car of the parts that still worked for resale and reuse. Still, if I recall, plastics, textiles, and other natural materials can make up between 15 to 20% by weight. So those car hulks are flattened and ready to go, right?
Well, there's only so much that's economical to remove by hand. Back before the shredder, that was a big challenge. A car would have to be cut up with torches or shears. It could take all day just to process one vehicle. As more and more cars were produced, the need for faster and more efficient recycling became more important. And that's where the shredder has made all the difference.
Before the invention of the polarizer in the early 1950s, processing large pieces of equipment, appliances, and cars was a slow and cumbersome process. By the early 1960s, industrial output had far outstripped the nation's ability to effectively dispose of these cast-offs. In 1964, First Lady Lady Bird Johnson called upon the nation to beautify America, pointing to abandoned vehicles on the side of the road and other eyesores. Widespread use of shredder technology soon eliminated this problem and helped change the face of the nation.
So when was the last time you saw a car rusting on the side of a road?
Can't say that I ever have. So now what sort of volume can you handle today?
Hundreds of cars in a day. You know, one of the biggest shredders in the world is said to be able to process 450 cars in an hour.
What? Yeah. That's incredible. So just how does a shredder work exactly? I mean, it's not like an office paper shredder. There must be some massive torque involved to be able to eat up a car in a matter of minutes. I can't wait to see that.
Hold on, Seth. The shredder is actually an integrated system of several different kinds of equipment. It's a process like any other manufacturing process, and the process actually starts out here.
Huh?
There are three phases to the process: the preparation of the inbound material, the shredding itself, and the separation of the shredded scrap. Each of them is critically important. Perhaps most important is what happens at the front gate to the yard. We recyclers have strict material acceptance policies designed to make sure that the material enters the yard without any substances of concern, and that unwanted components are already removed, such as gasoline tanks, oils, fluids, and other undesirable materials. You see those detectors?
Yeah.
Yeah, they check to see that there are no radioactive materials included in the loads, so there's no contamination downstream.
Oh, okay, yeah, that makes sense. I mean, radioactive material could contaminate everything it comes in contact with, all the way to the steel mill. So then the material acceptance policy is designed to keep the scrapyard safe and environmentally clean, and the product usable and consistent for the manufacturer.
Very good, Seth. You're a quick study.
So the recycler is processing these cast-off items to produce a feedstock for resale to a foundry or steel mill. I guess the cleaner the scrap and the closer to specification would make it more valuable on the market. Scrap is not waste. Recycling is not disposal, right?
Exactly.
Many of the products in use today contain substances of concern as part of their key components. These substances must be removed from the items before entering the shredder to prevent the release into the air, ground, and water. For example, refrigerants from air conditioners, lead from batteries, and mercury switches in automobiles and appliances. Material acceptance policies require suppliers to remove these types of components before they are accepted by the facility for shredding.
This pile here has all been carefully checked to make sure that it's now ready for shredding. Over there, you have a stack of car hulks. They've all had any materials of concern removed from them. They're okay. Flattened now and ready for safe and cost-effective transport to the yard. Here are other mixed metal materials that are often blended into the process to make the shredding more efficient. The crane operator carefully monitors what goes on the in-feed conveyor to ensure a steady flow of material into the shredder itself.
Okay. And now, I see how that feed roll cover prevents material from flipping onto the shredder housing, which I'm sure prevents downtime and maintains a safe, clean environment for the operation. Sarah, are we going to be able to go inside and see how the shredding actually takes place?
We can take a quick look inside while they're doing some regular maintenance.
Awesome.
When the machine's in operation, it's not possible to get inside because these huge hammers attached to the rotors are rotating and tearing the scrap into pieces. Now, each shredder is different, of course, depending on the size and type of the rotor, the horsepower, the linings, and the grate. Each of these hammers weigh about 450 pounds.
Wow.
Some of the largest shredders have hammers that weigh up to 1,200 pounds apiece. Our shredder runs at 6,000 horsepower.
Okay, so with 10 hammers flying around at 500 RPMs, you must be able to handle between, what, 150 and 200 tons per hour? I mean, if my math is right.
Well, that's about right on a good day, when there's no downtime, everybody's on their game. As the scrap is shredded into smaller and denser pieces, it eventually is forced through the holes in the grate to the conveyor below, where it's prepared for the separation process. When they've completed their maintenance, we'll take a walk upstairs to the control booth and see it all in action.
All right.
Okay.
The shredder control booth is the nerve center of process, and the operator is able to monitor all key functions, communicate with the crane operator and other workers supplying material to the shredder. He watches for safe operation as well as maximizing the flow of material through the shredder.
That was awesome. I can't believe I just saw an entire SUV devoured by that sucker.
I have to say, it never gets old.
Sarah, now can we see the downstream separation system, the eddy currents, and how you capture the non-metallic material?
Absolutely.
So, to start, the ferrous material is magnetically separated from the non-ferrous material.
The shredded material, now an amalgam of ferrous, non-ferrous, and non-metallic material, must be separated and cleaned as much as possible to ensure that component feedstock materials meet specifications. Foundries and steel mills have exacting specifications, which recyclers meet by use of a series of ingenious processes and equipment, collectively known as downstream separation. Through this elaborate system, over 70% of an automobile can be processed and recycled into its component materials. Research is underway to further recycle the auto shredder residue, or ASR, with hopes to extract an additional 20% of recyclable materials. In some jurisdictions, ASR is recognized as a reliable substitute for daily cover in landfills, further reducing dependence on virgin materials.
Okay, that was amazing. So all this material is ready to be used to make new cars?
Recycled scrap makes up about 70% of the 100 million tons of steel produced annually in the United States. This scrap right here is on its way to the foundry or steel mill where it'll be melted down into new steel that's used to make new cars, appliances, and other equipment.
And in the process, we saved a lot of energy and reduced the release of CO2 into the air. Actually, did you know that just one recycled car saves the equivalent of 502 gallons of gasoline and energy and reduces the greenhouse gas emissions by 8,811 pounds?
Really? I had no idea. Seth, recyclers are working every day to find ways to make the process more efficient and recycle more and more material. They're also working in partnership with manufacturers to design vehicles, appliances, and other products for better recyclability. It's called Design for Recycling. We could certainly use an engineering whiz like you to help us improve recycling at either end of the manufacturing cycle.
The Design for Recycling initiative, begun more than 25 years ago by the recycling industry, encourages manufacturers to think about the ultimate destiny of their products during the design stage of a product's development. Manufacturers must ensure that consumer products can be safely and economically recycled using existing recycling technology and methods when removed from service.
Well, Seth, what did you think of the shredder?
It's incredible. I can see how it's changed the recycling industry and made recycling an important part of how we take care of the planet. Not only are we conserving natural resources, we're saving energy and reducing harmful greenhouse gases.
Not to mention the benefit to the economy with over 138,000 workers in the recycling industry.
Well, thanks for taking me on the tour, Sarah. I can definitely see all kinds of possibilities for a career in recycling.
Tomorrow's recyclers will continue to improve on the efficiency of the shredding process, equipment, and practices in order to increase the rate of recyclability of all of our modern conveniences. With greater savings in energy, preservation of the land, air, and water, and conservation of virgin materials, recyclers are reshaping our modern landscape into a cleaner, safer, and brighter world.